fugitive emission. What exactly you mean by fugitive emission? Fugitive emission, as it explained in the slide, are air pollution emission that come from an oil refinery that is not under any control. That's the term fugitive. So in simple terms, any harmful, undesirable leakage to the atmosphere is termed as a fugitive emissions. Okay, so what are the harmful gases? A plant may be handling a steam. Is it a harmful to have the steam leakage to the atmosphere? No, though it is a loss to the company because steam which is generated is getting leaked to the atmosphere, but it doesn't do any harm to the atmosphere. If you are dealing with a gas like nitrogen, is it harmful? No, because the air itself contains nitrogen. So what we are talking about, volatile organic compounds called as VOC, like methane, right, propane, benzene, so which are all carcinogenic in nature, which can cause damage to the atmosphere. They are the ones which need to be controlled. Okay, so the definition is simple. It's a leakage of volatile organic compound, which I just mentioned to you, benzene, methane, you know, all those things, and which are hazardous air pollutants from sources like valve pumps or any other plant handling these VOCs. Okay, so this is the definition of a fugitive emission. And now let's see what is the effect of these harmful gases to the environment, right? So we find that VOCs are significantly there is a concern because they cause ozone depletion, they cause global warming, and as I mentioned, they are carcinogenic and harmful to the human beings. Okay, and these VOCs are a major contributor to the formation of summer smog through the world. So the slide what you see here gives a glimpses of the effect of global warming. We all saw the harmful emissions as a sort of effect on the environment. It depletes the ozone layer, you know, it causes the other effects of global warming. So you all would have seen, you know, melting glaciers, then the hurricane rainstorms which are happening, which never used to, the magnitude with which it is happening now was not seen in the earlier centuries. And you also see in our own country the extreme temperatures during summer and winter, you know, all these things. And we see a lot of species, you know, gets sort of distinguished and goes out of the system because of they are not able to adapt to the new environment. So the oil and gas industry contributes to the major emissions, because you all know that oil and gas industry deals with oil, crude oil, which is extracted from earth. Then there's a refinery which treats it. So the refinery produces the gases. Then these gases are, some of these gases are used in the chemical plants, chemical industries, which again produce some harmful gases. So any leakage of these from the plant is going to cause a global warming. And among the industries, there's if you take the valve industry segments, we cater to oil and gas predominantly. We cater to power industries. We cater to water industries, nuclear industries. So power industries, yes, deals with water, steam. Okay, The leakage to the atmosphere may not be harmful like what you see in oil and gas industries, but the losses will be there to the organization. Water industries, the same way. Nuclear industries handles hazardous materials, but there is a good control. The safety systems are there to avoid leakage of the radioactive materials. Okay, so you'll find that oil and gas industry is where you'll find the majority of the emissions are happening. Okay, so and particularly these gases, which are called green gases, are the CO2, CH4, which is methane, N2O is a nitric oxide, you know, all those things which causes warming of the environment. Okay, now it has been found that oil refineries release approximately about 250,000 tons of VOC every year. Okay, out of that, the methane part is about 35 million pounds. So this is the statistics people have accounted, and by and large, the methane constitute 10% of the greenhouse gases. Okay, next only to the CO2. You're all aware the CO2 is emitted by the automobiles and other things, right? So let's see what is the impact of all these emissions, and how countries are penalizing the plant which are emitting the harmful gases to the atmosphere. So if you take US, the US were pioneer in sort of enacting a lot of regulations to bring down the emissions. Environmental Protection Agency in the US had come out with regulations long years ago to control the emissions to 500 ppm and below. And then later on, a lot of federal states, they had their own requirements, like California used to have a limit of 100 ppm. Okay, so these EPA regulations, statutory regulations, used to levy fines or penalty for people or the plant which are violating these regulations. When some equipments are going to emit emissions greater than 500 ppm, and they are going to not complying to that, so the government has levied penalty. So what you see here, a Chevron paid 3.5 million civil penalty, okay, and equal amount to have a controls on the emissions. Then DuPont paid about $10 million, you know, as a penalty. So you'll find a lot of country companies, oil and gas companies, have been penalized, and that is why they have a requirement for low emission parts. So they, in turn, what they do is they put conditions that valve should have a low emission. In any refinery or any chemical plant or any plant, whatever you see around, the valves and pipe fittings, they form a major in terms of quantity, number of quantities. So equipments like heat exchangers, they are all A category items. The number wise, they will be very less. Whereas the valves and pipe fittings, the value wise, they will be about 20%, but the quantity wise, they will be about 80%. So let's see some statistics which has been found by studies. Leakage, take a refinery. Valves account for 35% of the total VOC emissions from the refinery. Okay, of this value, 85% of the emissions are coming from valves controlling the gases. So we all saw that gases are going to be the major contributor. Okay, if you take any valve, there are several modes of failures, right? There could be a body bonded joint which can leak to the atmosphere. There could be a gland packing through which a valve can leak. But the body bonded joint or body covered joint is a static joint, okay? Whereas the gland packing is a dynamic joint. So it has been found that 77% of the leakage which is happening from the valves are attributed due to stem packing. It is obvious because it is a dynamic packing. If you take a control valve, the leakage will be much more because it is going to be used quite often at intermediate position also, right? And similarly, leakage by component types also, if you take, if a refinery, this slide, what you see on the left side, it talks about the number of components in a typical refinery or chemical plant. So you'll find that valves will be the major one next to the pipe fitting connectors, correct? So other equipments like pumps, the connections, the pressure relief valves and all will be small, okay? And that is why you'll find typically the uncontrolled emissions from the plant will be more in valves because the quantity is also more, right? And you'll see here average emissions from a refinery on account of valves is about 408 tons per year, as against the total 650 tons per year from the entire plant. Okay, so that's why more focus is given on to the valves for getting a low emissions, right? And you all saw there are different types of valves. In the session we had covered about the multi-turn valves and quarter-turn valves. So quarter-turn valves, we said it is requires only 90 degree to open and close. Multi-turn valves or linear valves, it requires a linear movement. So always, whenever you have a linear movement, you will find that the leakage is more. And we also saw between gate and globe valve, the gate valve requires a longer stroke length compared to the globe valve. So that is why you will find among the valves, with different types of valves, the gate valve emissions are more, correct? So you will find that, 26%. I'm knocking off the control valves. So I did mention control valve leakage is more because control valves are stroked quite often. A gate valve may be used in on-off conditions, may not be used quite often. Whereas a control valve will be used quite often. Number of cycles of opening and closing or intermediate position will be more. Okay. So among the generic type on-off valve type, you'll find that gate valve constitute a major type other than the control valve. Okay. So in a typical refinery, again, people have done sort of a study and they found that, gate valve, the leakage percentage is around 32% of the total leak, right? So that's why the standards have gone in for more stringent norms in terms of a globe valve, gate valve. Now let's spend some time on the emission standards around the world. So there are national regulations on greenhouse gases, Kyoto Protocol, you are all aware. Then there is a EPA, which I didn't mention. Then there is a TA look, which is centric to the German and the German federal law. Okay, so these are the national regulations worldwide. And apart from that, the end users will have their own requirement, like a Shell, Exxon Mobil. They have their own norms for the emissions. And then we have the valve standards bodies like API, which is American Petroleum Institute, ISO, which is International Organization for Standardization, and MSS, Manufacturers Standardization Society. So these people have bring about various standards to control the emissions from the valves. And then the valve manufacturer, they may have their own practices. They may have their own standards to control the emission. Okay, so let's see a quick glance the type of standards available in practice now. So we saw federal laws. They are EPA 21. That is EPA is the pioneer. They were the first to introduce the regulation, and the method is called 21 method. Then we have the TA Luft, which is pertaining to the European and particularly Germany. And then the standards committee, like API, they brought in API 622 standard, basically for graphite packing. Then they graduated into API 624, basically for gate valve. And then the 641 for the quarter turn valves. And then these are the customer specific standards. Like Shell have got their own specifications. Chevron have got their own specifications. So when a customer says, I want a IS valve qualified to ISO 15448, then we need to design, manufacture and test according to that standard. When a customer says, I want the API standard, then we need to follow that. And some customers like Shell says, look, I have my own standard. I want you to qualify to this particular standard. So then case we need to qualify to that particular standard. Okay. So the knowledge on all these standard is essential for the valve manufacturer and also essential for the end users so that they can specify the right type of valve. Okay. So preferred and FP standard now, earlier was before 624 was released, the 622 and TA Luft were the preferred. So now also you'll find that the API standards are more popular in the Western countries like America, where the people, the API and all have got their headquarters there. So the American industries, they always follow API. The Europe, now they have the ISO standards. So ISO 15848 is widely popularly specified. Many of these, European countries and also the Eastern countries. Okay, so let's see how the API standard got evolved. The API had API 622 standard, which talks about qualification of the graphite packing used for low emission valves. This is the standard which was in vogue for a long time. And the customer will specify that I wanted a low emission valve, which is qualified as per API 622. So this standard will talk about, certain corrosion tests, weight loss tests. Then it will ask you to put it on a valve and then do the cycle for 1500 cycles, the thermal cycles. Then once that packing is qualified, then you can buy from the valve, that particular packing manufacturer. What happened was that the valve, the packing manufacturer would have qualified the packing. But if the valve manufacturer has not addressed the design, not addressed properly the manufacturing, then no matter how good the packing is, you may not get the low emission in the valve because you have not taken care in the design nor taken care in the manufacturing. So that is why API felt, look, this API 622 is not alone sufficient. So we need to put this API 622 qualified packing into a valve and then qualify the valve for low emission. So that is why that API 624 came into vogue. API 624 is basically for multi-turn valves, okay? The rising and non-rotating stem, okay? So basically, we all saw the linear valves or rising stem valves are gate valves. So predominantly, it talks about the gate and globe valves. Then, and of course, you have API 600 gate valves and then API 602 4-speed valve, which talks about the small sizes. Then later on, API 641 has been brought up for addressing the requirement for quarter turn bars. So API has seamlessly made changes to their standard and come out with a new standard so that the industry adapts to it, and the end product, what comes out of from the factory, is really able to meet the emission levels. Okay, so let's quickly see the two standards which are very popular and widely specified by the customers. One is the ISO 15848 part 1, and there's another part 2. So part 1 refers to qualification standard and part 2 refers to production standard. Okay, so don't bother about the part 2 now. So we are comparing the standard which is meant for qualification. The API 624 is a standard again which is meant for qualifying the valves. So let's see what the difference between these two standard. I just did mention API is widely used by the Americans, Western countries, and ISO the rest of the world. Okay, so the media of testing is helium or methane in ISO, whereas in API it is only methane. The test media is methane. That's the one big difference. Second difference is API has got a fixed values. Okay, you need to do this much cycles. You need to do the level is this 500 ppm. Whereas here in ISO, there are different categories of leakage. You have a class A, class B, class C. Okay, so again, within that you have a CO1, which means you have to do for 1000 cycles. CO2, you have to do for higher cycles. So here it is more like a minute driven, and whereas in API, it's a very prescriptive one. Okay, and API is basically for gate valves, right, or the linear valve, which is also the globe valve. Whereas ISO doesn't restrict to one type. So you can use ISO 15848 for quarter turn valves also. You can use it for multi turn valve also. That's the difference. Okay, then API restricts only graphite lab packing, whereas here ISO allows graphite, PTFE or billows also. There's no restriction on the packing materials what you use. Then the temperatures are defined very clearly in API, whereas here ISO, the user can select the pressure and temperature according to the category CO1, CO2, CO3. And more important is API doesn't allow gland adjustment, whereas gland adjustment is allowed in the ISO. In a gland packing, the gland nut is very, very important, and the gland nut provides the sufficient loading or packing pressure which provides the sealing. If there is a loosening of the gland load, then probably the media will start leaking. So one way of arresting the leakage is to tighten the gland nut. That is called a gland adjustment. Okay. Okay. API particularly deals with the methane gas, and you, when there is a leakage, it's going to mix in the air, and you're going to measure the concentration of methane in the air. That's why it's called part PPM measurement, sniffing method. Whereas ISO measures both. It can measure the PPM or it can measure the leakage rate. So there's a special equipment, the equipment used for ISO 15848 testing and equipment used for API 624 are different. If a valve is having a class A leakage, what does it mean is the leak volume, if you collect it, it will fill a golf ball in a period of 1 year time. That is the leakage. The same valve, if it is meeting class B, what does it mean? The leak volume will fill a soccer ball in 4 years or 10 tennis balls in a year. Okay, so that is the level of leakage of class B. So class C, as you really, as you see there, it will fill up in a soccer ball of in a year or 1000 tennis balls in a year. Okay, so you know from this representation, the class A is more stringent. So this, if a bar is required to meet class A, that means you know that bar is going to have a very little amount of leakage. Okay, so please understand, when I say leakage, is not going to be profuse leakage. We are talking about a leakage in terms of ppm, leakage in terms of what you see in this rate, you know, 4.4 into 10 power minus atmospheric cc per second. So that is the level of leakage we are talking about. These leakages cannot be picked up by the naked eyes. You have to use a instrument to pick up all these leakage. Four groups. Group A people have their own standards, like customers like Shell, Exxon, Mobil. Then the Group B customers, they follow the international standards like ISO 15848 or API or API 624. Then there are customers who specifies, I want only 100 ppm. Like I mentioned in the starting of the program, that California state, they made a requirement that all valves which get into their state should certify to 100 ppm as a requirement. So the end users who are located in the state of California will order a valve which meets 100 ppm as a requirement. And there are customers who don't bother about all these requirement. Okay, so you have a different groups of customers. Okay, when you see approach to fugitive emission in valves, we have a three-prong approach. So what are the three-prong approach? So one is in the design, where we are talking about the designing of stuffing box. The stuffing box means it is the component which houses the gland packing, gland follower and other things. Okay, then the selection of packing, then the testing. Okay, so the three-prong method is this: design, manufacturing and testing. So if you don't focus on these three things, and whatever may be the packing quality, superior quality packing, it may not produce the low emission what is required. A fugitive emission valve will require optimum surface finish in both the stem as well as in the stuffing box. Okay, it has been found stem with the N4, N5 finish is giving an optimal design. Similarly, the stuffing box with finish of N7 or N8 gives a optimum performance. Similarly, the geometric tolerance of the stem, the clearances between the components, all have to be controlled. Manufacturing, so you have a particular method of assembling the packing, then the tightening of the gland bolt and also the body bonnet joint. And when it comes to testing, so we have EPA method 21, which is a sniffing method, and then vacuum method and brushing method for ISO 15848. There are different methods for retaining the gland load. I just mentioned that loss of gland load can lead to leakage to the atmosphere. This is a standard stuffing box. So when you say the stuffing box, this is the pore which is present in the bonnet, which houses the packing. So this bottom is called bonnet bush. And then you have a series of packings, and then to compress the packing, you have a gland bush, and then there is a gland flange, and then there is a bolting which applies load to compress the packing. Only when the packings are compressed to the desired pressure or stress, you will find the sealing taking place in the bottom of the packing. For some reason, if the bolt load is relaxed, when it happens is that when you do thermal cycling, obviously, when you take it to a high temperature, then bring it down, so obviously there will be a loss of load, and bolt load may relax, or the packing, if it contains some impurities, then there will be a loss. So to avoid these bolt load relaxation, and then avoid a re-tightening of the bolt quite often, probably people use some arrangements called live loading. So the live loadings are with the belly washers. So when you go to the shop floor, probably you can see some valves will have their two or three spring washers, some will have a longer one. Okay. All the nuclear industries will go for this sort of arrangement because they cannot afford to have somebody to go and tighten it quite often. Valves refined, put in a refinery open area, probably they don't mind sending an operator or maintenance guy to go and tighten it and if it is a leak. Imagine a valve fitted in a containment area in a nuclear zone. Obviously, you won't allow anybody to enter into that. Okay, so that's why people in the refinery would ask for a live loading. Similarly, if you are handling a very critical gases, then probably customer would say, give me with a live loading arrangement. Okay, selection of the packing. These are some of the criteria for low emission valves: packing material, form, density, the cross sectional area, finish, clearance tolerance. These are all important things, and one has to give focus on all these things. So the types of packing used for low emission. So the most popular material is the combination packing, which is called, there are three die molded rings at the center and top and bottom braided one. So we call this as a combination packing. Then there's a packing which all have braided. Braided rings will be having a cut at the graphite yarns will be braided to form a ring. Here, the graphite will be molded to form a ring. So this is a endless ring and the braided rings are will have a cut. So there's another combination where you use all braided graphite packing. And then you have another category called cup and cone packing. So here the cup and cone, because you'll find that there is a cup and cone arrangement for each packing. Okay, so the all these things are found to give a different levels of sealing. In our experience in L&T valves, we found that all braided packing gives the lowest emission. Okay, so this is where some customers will specify fully braided packing. Some customers will still say that I want combination packing. People like Chevron who have a lot of work done on the fugitive emission, they understand the strength of this all braided and they specify this all braided. Okay, manufacturing. What is more important is that assembly procedure for gland, then the packing pressure you need to maintain. The design guys will calculate for each of the packing, what is the packing pressure to be maintained, and they'll specify it in the form of a bolt torque. Okay, these procedures, whatever tightening specified in the engineering documents, need to be adhered to in the shop floor. Only then you'll get the low emission required. So this is a typical arrangement, and you'll find that sealing place is taking place, you know, at the middle level of the packing, and this is the packing pressure, it varies. Okay, so while doing the packing, you need to have a proper alignment. I did mention this is the stuffing box, this is the number of packing gland and gland flange, and then the stud. So you need to have a uniform the gap. And there should not be any inclination. The gland flange, if it is inclined, it can cause a score mark. And then the score mark can cause a leakage to the atmosphere. So alignment is very, very important. And this is how typically a valve gland should look. The gap should be uniform throughout. And you should have a good anti-seize lubricant on the thread so that the frictional losses are minimized. Okay. So FE test methods, come to the final session. This is the test done for sniffing the gases. So you find the probe. This is a organic gas vaporizer. So this is the probe and he is sniffing at the body-bonded joint and measures the concentration. Okay. So the other method is helium leak detector. So what you find is this is a helium leak detector which can measure either helium ppm or helium leakage rate. Okay, so leakage rate means it will be in terms of standard cc per second, and sniffing method will give ppm. So you'll find the various methods are available for both prototype as well as production test. So these are some of the equipments which we are using for the measurement of fugitive emission. These are done on a gate valve where this is done using a vacuum method. That's why you'll find a vacuum chamber is there. And whenever this is something which we are measuring the concentration. Okay, so the stages involved, the low pressure test, high pressure test, shell test, then fugitive emission test, and then torque measurement. These are all the things which we do on qualifying a valve to fugitive emission test. Okay, and typically the API 624 talks about API 600 valves, and you have a range from 1 to 2 to 24 inch, class 150, 300, 600. The standard will say you need to do this 4 inch class 300, 12 inch class 300, 20 inch. If you do the sizes which is identified here as a T, then you qualify for the entire range. So the test will be either done at the independent laboratory or a laboratory which has been allowed, recognized by the end users. This is where we have done most of our tests, which is the Yarmouth in US. They are independent. Yarmouth Research Laboratory is an independent laboratory who does this qualification. This test is a quite expensive test and also time consuming test. Okay, so with that I close.